Hi everyone, it's this time of year again, the turning of the calendars and time of reflections and summaries. So it's also time for my annual list of my favorite movies of a year. Three quick points to make for everyone, especially who didn't see any of the previous lists. First of all, it's not an objective list of the best movies of the year, but rather my favorite ones. Some of them have evident flaws, some of them are far from perfect, but for one reason or another, they spoke to me, and I loved all these movies, and I'd like to recommend them to you. Secondly, I'm going by Polish release dates, which means you'll see some movies in here which technically premiered at the end of 2022, but came out in Poland later, at the beginning of 2023. Conversely, some of the movies where Polish release dates were delayed to 2024 didn't make the cut because I was unable to see them yet. Finally, as always, I call the clip the top 10 list, but as always, I extend the list a little bit more to include more movies. This time it's actually 15. The reason is I don't want to arbitrarily cut it off at 10 if there are a couple more notable films that are really worth highlighting, so I just sort of play it by ear. That's all you need to know, really. So let's see what were my top 10 favorite movies of 2023.
Truth be told, we helped the wrong person steal the wrong thing. We didn't mean to unleash the greatest evil the world has ever known. But we're gonna fix it.
So how do we pull that off?
Figure it out over a drink?
Probably best.
At number 15, Dungeons & Dragons Honor Among Thieves. And I know what you're probably thinking, but this is a silly fantasy film. Yes, true, but it's a really good silly fantasy film. It's got great characters, great humor, well-made action, and perhaps most importantly, unlike many of the other recent Hollywood blockbusters like Marvel, DC, Star Wars, it felt refreshingly sincere, genuine, and uncynical. It doesn't feel like it was made to be just a product. It's a story that the creators clearly cared about. Plus, as much as I appreciate serious cinema, some films are made just for entertainment, and I like those as well. And I think it would be disingenuous for me to not reflect that in my list.
You looks paid for the tickets. Not bad, huh?
So what do you do?
I sell shit.
The success of a luxury cruise mainly depends on you. I don't want to hear anybody saying no. Yes, sir! Yes, ma'am!
At number 14, Triangle of Sadness, a darkly comedic social satire which laughs at wealth, class, and what happens to those concepts in a situation of ultimate crisis. I liked it quite a lot, and I think the scene with the Russian bozo drunkenly commandeering the cruise ship's intercom was so hilarious that it immediately earned the film its spot on the list. Is the social commentary here subtle? No, absolutely not. But is it biting anyway? You betcha. Number 13, Godzilla Minus One. This is the latest Japanese kaiju film, and it's actually quite impressive how much of a serious, riveting drama it manages to be. It absolutely isn't just a silly film about a giant destructive monster. It's a competent story about PTSD, guilt, regret, and finding a new will to live. And on top of that, it just happens to have some haunting scenes involving the actual monster. To top it all off, it was made on a budget of $15 million, which is peanuts compared to some of the Western blockbusters, and makes the movie all that much more impressive.
If you win, the table will honor its word. You will have your freedom.
Under the old laws, only one can survive. Failure to meet at sunrise will result in execution.
Last words, Winston?
Just have fun out there.
At number 12, John Wick Chapter 4, another installment in one of the best action franchises in the history of cinema. This one is, for my money, the best movie in the series, with the exception of the very first one. The action is nothing short of spectacular. The ridiculous characters are taken straight out of anime stories. The vibe is incredibly cool, and as always, the technical aspects of the film, particularly the way the action is choreographed and shot, are absolutely jaw-dropping. I don't think any other movie this year had a third act this exciting. And also, a lot of the action this time around features not only Keanu Reeves, but also Donnie Yen. So, what's not to like?
And if you don't stop bothering me, I have a set of shears at home. And each time you bother me from this day on, I'll take those shears and I'll take one of my fingers off with them. And I'll give that finger to you until I have no fingers left. Does this make things clearer to you?
Not really, no.
Starting from now. But shush like, Polly. You know, shush like.
Yeah, I'd shush like.
Would you not want him to have to do the one finger to see if he was bluffing, like?
No, we wouldn't.
Because worse comes to worse, he can still play the fiddle with four fingers, I bet ya.
Going back to your own gang now, Potter.
I'm talking to me!
At 11, The Banshees of Inisherin, latest film from one of my favorite working directors, Martin McDonagh, a wonderfully dark mixture of comedy and tragedy about the sort of unjustified conflict between friendship and ambition, which carries heavy echoes of commentary about the Irish Troubles. Phenomenal performances from everyone in the film, great cinematography, and a permeating air of sadness and inescapable sorrow. Heavy, but great.
What a good story this is. Childhood sweethearts who reconnect 20 years later and realize they were meant for each other. In the story, I would be the evil white American husband standing in the way of destiny.
Shut up.
He was just this kid in my head for such a long time. I think I just missed him.
Did he miss you?
Hands on!
At 10, Past Lives, perhaps one of the most realistic portrayals of longing, nostalgia for lost love, and wonder about what could have been that I've seen in cinema. The script and performances make the movie feel so realistic, it makes you forget these are just actors playing their parts. Bittersweet, heartfelt, romantic, beautifully shot, and with an ending that will tear your heart out.
This wealth should come to us.
Their time is over.
It's just gonna be another tragedy.
When this money started coming, we should have known it came with something else. They're like buzzards circling our people. We're still warriors.
At number 9, Killers of the Flower Moon, latest film from Martin Scorsese, terrific adaptation of an already terrific book, which itself describes a story made even more chilling as a result of being completely real. Scorsese takes a long, hard look at one of the atrocities of American history and does it with impressive skill. The film looks fantastic, flows really well, especially for such a long runtime, and features excellent performances from such high-caliber actors like DiCaprio and De Niro, who amazingly are still eclipsed by Lily Gladstone. I thought it was very good, but the ending sequence put it in the excellent category for me, with the way the director looks at the audience and says, yeah, I'm not innocent either.
I don't know what happened, I think he fell off that third floor, the window's open.
The autopsy report is inconclusive. An accidental fall is going to be hard for us to defend. That's why there's an investigation for a more suspicious death. Because you were the only person there. And of course, you're his wife.
Stop. I did not kill him.
That's not the point.
At number 8, Anatomy of a Fall, a riveting thriller about a woman put on trial for possibly murdering her husband. fantastically ambiguous, always playing with the audience's preconceptions, conclusions, and expectations. In terms of the script, it's crafted almost to perfection, but it really comes alive thanks to the incredible central performance from Sandra Hüller. For a film which consists almost entirely of people talking, it's amazing how engaging it manages to be. At number 7, Decision to Leave, Park Chan-wook's first feature film since The Handmaiden. This new one is a delicious mixture of intrigue, thriller, and romance, which never ceases to feel like you're watching someone eat the forbidden fruit. It's got a very unique narrative structure, it looks absolutely spectacular, and the creative editing is the unsung hero of the technical aspects. It makes some of the scenes flow together so well, it's just a genuine pleasure for the eyes. Yet another example of why Korean cinema is so cherished in the recent years.
I think what we have here in Hollywood is high art. It's
party time, sparkle time!
If you could go anywhere in the whole world, where would you go?
I always want to be part of something bigger.
Yes.
Let's go! Something that lasts, that means something.
You know, when I first moved to L.A.,
I got your face tattooed on my back.
You know what the signs on all the doors read? No actors or dogs allowed. I changed that.
Good morning.
Good job for you.
I'll do anything.
That's the cocksucker they sent to screw us.
Yeah! At number 6, Babylon, latest film from Damien Chazelle, which ended up being really divisive. Some people loved it, some people were very disappointed by it. I'm in the former camp. I thought it was brilliant, even though, yes, it was also flawed. The ending is a bit too on the nose, the film is maybe too bloated and long and too chaotic and messy all around, but I think it fits the story it's telling. It adds to the vibe of old Hollywood, a wild, unpredictable, sort of Wild West with its approach to business and filmmaking and treating the people in the industry at the time. It's got a great cast of memorable characters, some spectacular individual sequences like Margot Robbie's first sound scene or Tobey Maguire's appearance in the film. Looks and sounds great as Chazelle movies always do. I can understand why you criticize this film and why you could dislike it, but for me, it worked rather well.
What did the hand feel like?
It felt amazing. I could see and feel everything on the other side. So my mom, she was trying to reach out.
Mom. I'm here.
Still been saying stuff.
You mean saying stuff?
What if we open the door but we didn't shut it?
At number 5, Talk to Me, the only horror on the list, but what a horror film it was. A concept that manages to feel somewhat original, great performances from some young and unknown actors, and a couple of sequences that terrified the shit out of me, with not sudden jump scares, but on a conceptual level. It just presents you with a scenario which is so utterly hopeless, evil, and soul-crushing, and does it in such a visceral way, it really leaves a mark. And all the while, the film still manages to be a very creative metaphor about a really sort of grounded and real-life phenomenon. Great example of using a small set of filmmaking tools to create something really effective.
Thank you.
How's the writing going?
Not so well. I keep hearing something.
Schopenhauer measured a man's intelligence against his sensitivity to noise.
Do you ever find yourself overwhelmed by emotion?
Yes. Yes, it does happen.
At number 4, Tar, a tour de force from Cate Blanchett, who carries the story about ego, power, abuse of that power, and the consequences that may eventually catch up to you. It's coldly brutal as a character study with hints of a ghost story. It's gripping even in the slower dialogue scenes, and I think it's wonderfully subversive, because making the same story about a male central character would feel like a very regular thing, but having it be about a woman suddenly flips a lot of the preconceptions upside down and makes for a much more interesting point.
Miles, being Spider-Man is a sacrifice. You have a choice between saving one person and saving every world.
Send me home.
I can't do that.
I can do both! Spider-Man, always!
Not always.
What about Uncle Ben?
If not for Uncle Ben, most of us wouldn't be here.
Can't stop me now!
At number 3, Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, the only animated film this time around, and also the only movie that I gave a full 10 out of 10 score this year. I never expected it to be on the same level as its predecessor, and then it really was. Its animation quality is simply unparalleled and continues to break new ground, and I think, safe to say, influence other filmmakers already. The story was surprisingly well done. I really feared that really going into a multiverse would be superficial and remove the actual personal stakes, but the film actually manages to do the opposite and focus on the most personal of the personal aspects of Spider-Man. All the while also being a meta-commentary on Spider-Man's history as a character in media by asking the question, does Uncle Ben or the respective mentor figure have to die in order for Spider-Man to become Spider-Man? Does the narrative beat have to occur for this character? And yes, we have to wait for the ultimate answer for the last movie in the trilogy to deliver it, but if the third part is as good as the first two, this will be one of the absolute best trilogies of all time.
My parents, they've got problems.
What kind of? What do you mean, problems?
I don't think I'll ever go home again.
Well, why don't you come home with me? Come to Saltburn.
Mr. Quick.
Wow.
And here he is now.
Oh, what beautiful eyes. Oh, how wonderful.
Yeah, I told you it wasn't a minger.
Oh, but darling, you're kind about everyone. You can't be trusted.
I had them hang up an old school dinner jacket. We dressed for dinner here.
Dressed for dinner?
Yeah, it was like black tie.
I think I like you even more than last year's one.
You're so,
So what?
Real.
At number 2, Saltburn, a late addition to the list, but a movie that really won me over before it even ended. Emerald Fennell's follow-up to Promising Young Woman is absolutely electric as a subversive vampire story thrown onto the canvas of social dynamics and class warfare. A vampire story without supernatural elements, I might add. It looks positively gorgeous. Every actor and actress in it is on top of their game, and at times it does cross the line of good taste, and at times it made me groan and look away from the screen, but damn if it isn't wholly entertaining. Very, very close to a perfect film.
Non pensavo di trovare un amico come Bruno nella vita.
Ciao, Bruno!
Né che l'amicizia fosse un luogo dove metti le tue radici. E che resta ad aspettarti. Ciao Bruno.
Ciao Pietro.
Negli ultimi 10 anni con mio padre non ci ho mai parlato.
Lo so.
Mi parlava di me.
Quando tuo papà l'ha vista, ha voluto costruire la casa qua.
Ha chiesto a me di costruirla.
L'unica cosa che mi serve è il manovale.
And my favorite movie of 2023 is The Eight Mountains, a relatively lesser-known Italian feature that completely blew me away and left me a sobbing mess. I don't think any other movie in the last several years has had this much of an emotional impact on me. I think it's a must-watch for all men especially, because it's the quintessential film about masculinity. Not in the sense of driving fast cars, fist-fighting and picking up beautiful women. No, in the sense of building a literal house, climbing mountains, exploring a male friendship, a relationship between a son and a father, a role that a man fulfills in his family. It is just spectacular. Between the story, performances, sweeping shots of scenery, a lot was shot on location in the Italian Alps, and the music, which to this day makes me a bit emotional just listening to it. A beautiful picture in the truest sense of the word, and I hope more people hear about it and decide to check it out.